Roll call to the town clerk, please.
Chairman Chappell?
Yeah.
Councilor Cosell? Here. Councilor Freeman?
Here.
Councilor Galbraith?
Here.
Councilor Jordan?
Yeah.
Councilor Hodges?
Here.
Councilor Wong?
Thank you. Join me. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I know the spell.
We had two meetings, the minutes of the third meeting held July 12, 1993, and July 19, 1993. I have one more question.
So many.
All those in favor? 6-0.
This is the new page, is that correct?
With the amended page.
Yes, with the, I'm sorry, with the amended page. So we had one page that was wrong, and we picked right up. Now we have a citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Anybody that would like to come up and tell us anything that's not on the agenda tonight, why now's the time or forever hold the peace. Thank you. Reports and correspondence. Any reports tonight? Mike McGovern.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just very pleased to report we received a letter from the Office of Comprehensive Planning, which is a state level saying that the 1993 Elizabeth Comprehensive Plan has been reviewed and approved. That is a process that has been ongoing for about 5 years. Very positive. If anyone would like to see these, they are available to be seen here at the town office. They will be in the library, probably not tomorrow, but later in the day tomorrow, and they'll be available if anyone would like their own copy for $8, available for purchase here at the town office.
Oh. Mike, I'm curious, how many towns have an approved plan?
I don't know that information, sir.
Relatively few.
Probably 35, 40.
Anything else? Councilor Jordan.
Yes, I have another thing that I would like to mention. I went to IWS on a meeting here, the village on the 15th day of July, and our chairman, the town council, Dave Chappell, received a regional waste system award, and for his dedication and services and loyalty to the IWS. And talking to some of the people there, I understand that he's done a tremendous job in representing the town of Cape Elizabeth, and I was glad to see him receive this award. I'll hold it up here and pass it around. Everybody can see it. Anybody can see it. Very nice. He's done a very good job, as I understand.
Thank you.
Those
kind words, thank you.
Yes, indeed. Congratulations.
Any other reports or correspondence tonight? Councilor Freeman.
Yes, it's nice and early in the evening, so many watching won't probably get to item 51, the last item on the agenda tonight. This is to consider establishing a date for a special town council election to fill the vacancy to be created by the resignation of myself. Just wanted to say at the beginning of the meeting that it is certainly a singular pleasure to serve Cape Elizabeth on the town council going on my sixth year now. It was much more easy to resign from my job than it was to contemplate leaving Cape Elizabeth with all the wonderful people that we have met over the last 8 years, both in serving on the council, in serving on the Cumberland County Budget Advisory Commission, as well as having the pleasure of serving at the National League of Cities level on behalf of Cape Elizabeth, really has been a wonderfully fulfilling chapter in my life, and certainly all of the things that my wife and children have been able to benefit from by being citizens of Cape Elizabeth is a real privilege that we all very much appreciate, and we hope to be back. We understand that Buffalo has a couple of more inches of snow than Cape Elizabeth, but thankfully we're skiers, and we hope to settle in reasonably successfully. But thank you to all the citizens of Cape Elizabeth for the opportunity to have served you.
I've got to take the chairman's prerogative here, kind of, and say a couple of words about Wayne leaving. I think I can give you an idea of how great it's been having him on the council, especially when you're able to take a trip together. We went to Washington, Wayne and I, and Mike, for the National League of Cities when he was chairman, and I've got to tell you this story about it. We get outside the hotel, and we say, where are we going today? Sunday afternoon. There wasn't too much going on. Let's go to the zoo. How far is it? About 15 minutes. Well, this is what Wayne got known there, 15-minute Wayne. It was only 4.5 miles, and we made it all right, and we made it back, puffing a little bit, but that I'll never forget as long as I live, Wayne standing there and saying, 15 minutes approximately. So with that, like, it's been great serving with you.
Thank you.
Great. We're now up to our...
Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I would like to add something to that. I went to Washington once with the National League of Cities, and the manager was taking me for a short walk one afternoon. I can't tell you how many miles it is, but I think we walked for 3 hours or more. I was all in, and he was still going strong when we got back to the hotel. That night at the banquet, I mentioned it to two or three people, and they said, you walked all that distance this afternoon? I said, that's right. I kept up with him somewhere or another.
Any other reports, correspondence? We're now up to the public hearing on the master plan for Riverside Memorial Cemetery. We have the chairperson of the Riverside Memorial Cemetery trustees here. We can answer any questions that might come up. Is there anybody that would like to come forward, give their name and their address, and talk for or against the Riverside Memorial Cemetery Master Plan? If so, why, we welcome you right now. Seeing nobody, we'll call the public hearing closed, and we'll go to item 35. To consider approving the master plan for Riverside Cemetery and take any necessary action. Council, will somebody make a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I'd be delighted to move that we approve the master plan for the Riverside Cemetery this evening. It's an extraordinary piece of work, and you've done a wonderful job.
Been moved and seconded that we approve the master plan for the Riverside Cemetery. All those in favor? 6-0. Thank you. Item 36. To consider designating the Riverside Cemetery Fund 63093 balance as $200,000 to perpetual care and the balance to the Capital Improvement Fund and $10,200 be spent from the Capital Fund to implement phases 1 and 1A of the cemetery master plan and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman, I would move item number 36 as expressed.
I'll second the motion.
It's been moved and seconded on item 36. All those in favor?
Wait.
I'm sorry.
You can ask questions after it's been moved and seconded.
I'd be delighted to have a question.
My question is to the manager, is $200,000, maybe it's clear, but I don't quite understand, $200,000 for perpetual care and the balance of capital improvement fund. What is the balance of the capital improvement fund? And it says $10,200 be spent for the capital fund to implement phase 1 of the money.
I didn't bring the numbers with me. My recollection is, as of 6/30/92, it was around an additional $77,000.
Okay. Good.
It's gone up a little since then.
That's all I have.
Does that take care of Council Dillon?
Yes, sir.
Any other questions? All those in favor? 6-0. Item 37, to consider designating proceeds from future lot sales at Riverside Cemetery with 50% to perpetual care and 50% to capital improvements and take any necessary action.
I move the adoption.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? All those in favor? 6-0. That takes care of everything for the Riverside Memorial Cemetery. Stay right with us. We got an interesting meeting tonight. Don't you dare go away. Item 38, to consider scheduling a public hearing on a proposed school improvement program for the September 13, 1993 Town Council meeting and take any necessary action.
Council Chairman, I would like to move that we hold a hearing for the school improvement program, public hearing for the school improvement program at our meeting on September 13th, 1993.
Thank you.
I'll second the motion.
Moved and seconded. Discussion?
With a comment, I think you should have the time. It's at 7:30 p.m.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 6-0. Item 39, to consider recommendations from the Sewer Board of Appeals regarding a proposed Portland Water District South Portland Sewerage Agreement contract amendment and take any necessary action. Mike McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Very pleased to present this to you. This has been extensively reviewed by the Board of Sewer Appeals in their capacity as advisors on sewer projects. It's also been reviewed by the town attorney. We had it looked at by our former town engineer, Bob Hunter, on a gratis basis to make sure that we weren't missing anything since he had been involved in the contract back in 1974. It's been reviewed by the council, Portland Water District, Peter Webster, to be sure that it is in the best interest of the town. It's been reviewed by the South Portland City Council, and it's been approved by the South Portland City Council. It's been reviewed by the Portland Water District trustees and has been approved by them in this substantial form, subject to the approval of the paperwork of the town council. Basically, what it would do is to take the existing agreement with South Portland that was first signed back in the 1977-1978 period. It would extend it beginning from now for a period of 30 years, which is beneficial for the community in that it gives us the guaranteed capacity for that longer period of time instead of having the sewer pulled out from under us, although that would be difficult to do. It also reduces our ownership share in the treatment plant from 1/11th of the treatment plant to 1/13th. We didn't feel it was in our best interest to continue to own 1/11th of the treatment plant. We simply felt that we do not need that capacity in the northern end of town that this sewer treatment plant serves. The city of South Portland is under a consent agreement that they signed with the Department of Justice for the upgrade of the treatment plant. That is what brings this before you and what brings it to the forefront at this time. Under that consent agreement, the plant is being greatly increased in capacity, as I mentioned. An important point with it as well is that all of the South Portland agreements with the EPA and the Department of Justice provide that flow shall be measured on a one-month basis when they look at whether or not they're going along with the license or not. South Portland has been very agreeable on this with us to provide that our flow would be based on a six-month basis. That means that we can have more variance in the ups and downs over a six-month period than you might have in a month. which is extremely beneficial. The earlier agreement provided that was based on 1 year and was based on 500,000 gallons. Under this, it would change from 500,000 at the 111th level to 715,400 gallons at the 113th level. However, it would be on a six-month basis instead of on a one-year basis. The cost of this, had we not negotiated this, or had the district, excuse me, not negotiated this, would have been in excess of $900,000 to be paid over a period of time. As you can see from a related paper that was in your packet that the sewer board is still continuing to review, the cost of this is such that it's closer to $765,000 and that it will be paid for over the next 30 years with funds coming from sewer connections. Nothing in this contract specifically would at all increase sewer rates. It would be paid for by new connections that would occur over the next 20 to 30 years. I think the only other point I'd like to make on this is I really regret bringing this before you when it needs to be adopted by the end of the month. Unfortunately, I was not aware that South Portland was had the deadlines that they do have in having to meet the consent decree. We only found out about that about 3 weeks ago. I think it's an excellent agreement. It's well positions us to continue to implement the comprehensive plan, and I think it also fits very well with a package of recommendations that the sewer committee is looking at. When the sewer committee discussed this, there was some concern as to what makes 715,400 the number of gallons that it ought to be. Should have we looked for instead of 113th, 114th, or whatever? In the end, the majority of that committee did feel that this was the appropriate amount, but as the cover note indicates from the board, they all feel that projecting flows is an inexact science, and they really would like to see a strong preference as well concurrently given to reducing inflow and infiltration. And that report, with all those recommendations and a series of others, my sense is will be before you next month. They will be reviewing a second draft of it that was written based on the comments at an earlier meeting. They will be reviewing that this Thursday night. But my sense is this really positions Cape Elizabeth well to continue to implement the comprehensive plan that you have before you. And also, this evening really doesn't tie you down to indicating, you know, if there is any additional capacity where it might go. That any additional capacity comes about must first be documented, and second, it must be based on new ordinances, which you still need to review and maintain. So I give this agreement my strongest possible endorsement and would encourage you to favorably support it. Dan Jellis, who's the general manager, chief honcho of the Portland Water District, is here to answer any questions you may have, as well as David Golombewski, who is the director of wastewater operations. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. We have a motion from somebody, so we get this thing started, and then we'll have discussion. Councilor Jordan?
I can't yield to the
Councilor
lady.
Councilor Coggeshall? Well, one of you.
I move that we approve the sewer service contract as presented this evening.
I'll second it.
Moved and seconded that we approve the sewer contract as presented this evening. Discussion. Councilor Coggeshall?
I did have several questions, but in Mr. McGovern's presentation, he answered all my questions, so I don't know if anyone else has.
He did a good job, didn't he?
Yes, excellent.
After that presentation, there shouldn't be any questions. Can we have a vote? All those in favor? 6-0. Item number 40, to consider accepting the town center plan and take any necessary action. May we do the same again? Somebody with a motion, and we'll get it seconded, and we'll go into discussion and see what happens. Councilor Coggeshall.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the town center plan. Do you want me to read the order? having held a public hearing on June 14, 1993, does hereby accept a town center plan dated May 1993, component of the town of Kingsbury comprehensive plan. In accepting this report, the town council certified adopted the town center vision and goals as contained in page 2 of the plan. The recommendations on pages 3, 4, and 5 are not formally being adopted, but shall be a guide as the town center planning and zoning evolves over the coming years. The town council further, number 1, refers to the planning board responsibility for drafting recommended town center zoning provisions and requests a report no later than June 30, 1994. 2, refers to the town manager the responsibility of developing cost estimates relating to pedestrian, utility, and stormwater improvements, and requests that he explore intergovernmental funding sources to assist with any work that may be considered. Number 3, directs the town manager to discuss with the Maine Department of Transportation the possibility of redirecting MDOT funds currently set aside for traffic light on Route 77 from Scott Dyer Road intersection to instead be utilized for redesigning that intersection. Request number 4, requests the school department to complete updating comprehensive traffic and parking plans. The town council, in accepting this plan, is very cognizant of the limited financial resources. Any improvements to occur need to be respectful of other demands on the property tax and on limitations on the ability of citizens to sustain additional taxes. In conclusion, we wish to acknowledge and thank the Town Center Planning Committee, including Chairman Bruce Cosell and members Thomas Henry, Joseph Foley, Gerald Murray, Rosemary Reed, Thomas Tinsman, Peter Irwin Chapel, Carl Pearson, and Kathleen Connor. We also thank Town Planner Maureen O'Mara for dedicating, assisting the committee, Don Mitchell for donating professional landscape architect services, and citizens of Cape Elizabeth for their input into this process. Their collaborative work provides a new vision for the center of our community.
Thank you, Councilor Cosell. May we have a second?
I will second that motion.
Thank you. Discussion? Councilor Dalbec.
I think we need to correct some dates.
Yeah, could you do a microphone test too for, is it, make sure it's on?
Now we're on.
And Mrs. Cosell's too.
Now it is.
Sorry.
Sorry about that, folks at home, but it was a very nice motion that you didn't hear.
And I'm not going to read it again.
Dates. This refers to the report of May 1993. There was a new report submitted, revised recommendations dated August 1993. Now we either have to amend and use the August 1993, or we have to state that vision number 8 of the May report is not included in what we have accepted. Vision number 8, for those listening, stated create a standing town center implementation committee, etc., and that is something that I don't think we are including. It was left out of the revised one that was put in.
Councilor Cosell.
I'll amend my motion to read the town planner sent town center plan dated May 1993 and as amended as of August 1993.
I will second that amendment.
Further discussion? Yes, Councilor Jordan.
I have one question. Is why did we end up request the school department for the traffic and parking plans? Why was that done? I didn't remember it that way. I thought the town was going to do that. It's all part of the town, and it... they were interested in their parking as far as around the school complex, but I didn't know it was put upon the school department for the Same town.
Yeah, if I may, Mr. Chairman, this draft motion does not require the school department to do a traffic study off the school grounds. In the first town center plan, it recommended they do a comprehensive traffic study on the school grounds, and my recollection is that parking was added to be made a part of that somewhere through the process. Nowhere does this draft motion suggest that the school department do anything other than on the school grounds.
Well, I can interpret that they, if you're requesting a complete update, traffic impact, they don't say, it just says school department to do it, and it don't say school grounds. To me, it would imply for the whole town center.
You know, if you'd like, maybe you'd like to offer an amendment that adds request the school department to update the comprehensive traffic and parking plans for the school complex, if you want that to be clear.
I'd like to hear from other councilors, but I would feel much better. Maybe I'm off base, but...
I'd be comfortable with that amendment for clarity for everybody, and I believe that is consistent with what is being done now by the school building committee.
Further, yes?
The original recommendation was for the entire school campus, and I'll amend number 4 to include those words. That would satisfy everyone.
I would second that.
That's all I have.
Thank you. Further discussion? Councilor Martin.
I would like to emphasize that this motion adopts the town center vision and goals contained on page 2 of the plan, and that the recommendations on page 3 and 4 are not formally being adopted, but serving as a guide for the zoning and planning in the years to come. I think that's an important distinction to make.
Thank you. Any other discussion?
Oh, yes, I have one more. Nothing too serious, but I would think if brush needed to be cleaned up along 77 or any other street in the town, we wouldn't have to put it in this document of a certain area of Route 77. I thought that was going to be stricken from the document.
My understanding when I did this redraft, based on what I heard you discussing at the last meeting, was that you were not adopting any of the town center plan recommendations. You weren't going to take them in or take them out, and that you were just simply having them serve as a guide. You know, by what you're suggesting now, Councilor Jordan, is to remove one of those items, and that is not what my understanding would desire to come.
I would not mind that being left in since it's been accomplished. This week.
Tomorrow when I see you, Bill, I'll show it to you.
You sure don't mean explain it to me also? Did you do it? No, I just feel anything that's in the document that people will hold it up in front of you someday and say, hey, this was adopted by the council. Tell us what the other language is, and I'll stick to that.
Thank you. Any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion as seconded, please raise your hand. 5 and 1 against.
That's right.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, could I respectfully request that we take an item out of order, item number 47, if we could take that out of order. I think there's a representative from the Papuda Club available at this moment.
Any objections to taking an item out of order? If so, raise your hand. We will do it. Item number 47.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
As a member of Caputa Club, I would ask to abstain from this conversation.
To consider a request from the Caputa Club to operate games of chance on September 11, 1993, and take any necessary action.
I'd move the request, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? All those in favor? One, two, three, five, zero. Thank you.
May I just add one comment?
Yes.
About my hesitation on approving this. It has more to do with the current policy that is still present at Caputa, where it has restricted tee times for men and women in certain parts of the week. I thought that that was being considered to open it up for everyone, no matter what their sex. If they're a business person, male or female, they should be able to play when everyone else does. That was my hesitation.
Thank you, Councilor Powers. Item 41. To consider the expiration of the emergency ordinance regarding expansion of non-conforming structures in the critical wetland zone and applicable wetland buffers and take any necessary action. Mr. McGowan?
You have three opportunities before you this evening. One is to take no action. Two is to continue the emergency moratorium that was in place enacted 89 days ago. Or three, enact another emergency ordinance with whatever language you would like this evening.
Councilor Cogashaw?
Mr. Chairman, I would like to move that we extend the present moratorium for another 90 days. And I'll explain my reasons after.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we extend the present moratorium for another 90 days. Second. Anybody second? Yes, we did. Discussion? Councilor Cogashaw?
My reason for moving this has several facets. Number one, the planning board spent two meetings making recommendations on changes in the ordinance that would help to clarify the issue. The wording was found to be confusing by the Zoning Board of Appeals, and I think it is good government to have clearly written ordinances. Another part of this non-conforming use is what's called the inverse setback that almost takes an engineer's mind to figure out really what is being said. The ordinance committee has spent two intense, long evenings further clarifying the planning board recommendations. I feel that the town council could possibly act with one workshop, maybe one and a half workshops, and bring it before the public again for a hearing, and that we could do this before another 90 days has expired. But with all the work and effort that's put in to correct, to make these changes in the ordinance, I don't feel it's fair not to continue this so we can complete our job. We also have many important items coming up before us within the next month or year, and it would be nice if we could correct those ambiguities so in the future we won't be wasting time on this again, and we can deal with sewer ordinances, school development, public safety buildings.
Thank you. Further discussion? Councilor Jordan?
Well, I understand what Councilor Cogashaw had to say about extending it, but I don't feel that we need to extend it. I feel that we need to work on the ordinance and do some redrafting, as you might say, but I don't see any flood permits coming in or whatever might come in. until we got the information corrected. I just feel that, I know some work has got to be done on it, and I feel that we can do it. We'll be back in a few days again to do it, and I don't feel that it's necessary.
Thank you, Counselor Jordan. Counselor Bellbeck?
I would agree with Counselor Coggeshall. I think that we could create confusion and potentially get some flood of applications in if we leave it in a confused state. And since there isn't a flood of applications, I think we're better off personally leaving it or leaving the moratorium on for the next 90 days until we can get the council to clarify everything, and that will take a little bit of work.
Thank you, Counselor. Any further discussion? Are you ready to vote? Sorry, Counselor Marvin.
The manager had mentioned that we had three options. We could not do anything. We could continue for 90 days. And what was the third option?
Adopt another emergency ordinance of whatever language the council chooses.
And you don't have one, so you've got the first two.
And if we do nothing, that means we just don't have... okay. So that would be the same as what Councilor Jordan is talking about then.
Okay. Anything else?
I just have one.
Yes.
Other thing I skipped over was the fact that we, as a council, had a very superficial discussion at the end of a workshop, and as a group, we have not really discussed these changes. And I think we need to do that.
Councilor Carter. Councilor Carter.
I would just remind my colleagues that this particular vote needs 5 members to the affirmative for it to carry. It is an emergency ordinance.
That's right.
Thank you. Now, can I just ask a question to make sure we know exactly where we're going? We can't do number 3, that's out. So we got no action or an emergency moratorium. If we do no action, the old rules went into effect that we had before. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Town manager? If we do no action.
That's right. The language that was in place prior to the enactment of the emergency ordinance.
Right. Okay.
Can I ask another question?
Yes.
No. Would that be in line with the state guidelines then, or would that be different?
It's the way we had it before, which was the 25%.
Which agrees with the state guidelines?
No.
No.
The state's 30%.
No, it's more restrictive.
More restrictive. This is an important one, so take your time. Okay, we're going to vote. We have a motion that we extend the moratorium for another 90 days. It has been seconded. All those in favor of extending the moratorium for another 90 days, raise your right hand. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5-0, it carries.
5-1.
5-1. Oh, I'm sorry.
5-1.
Item number 42. To consider a report from the town manager regarding restructuring of boards, commissions, and committees, and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, this report was prepared at the request of the town council. It essentially tries to build on the very successful board and commission system that we now have in the town, trying to encourage maximum citizen involvement, but trying to encourage it in ways that are constructive. In looking at the different boards and commissions, it's felt that a number of them perhaps have outlived their usefulness, and perhaps the talents of the individuals who are on those particular boards could be better channeled in other directions. It's proposed that a number of other standing boards become more or less ad hoc committees or task forces, and that all of the committees be required each year to go through a goal-setting process and to submit budget. My sense is that it's very good to review. I know on my part, what are the aspects of our boards and what are some of their weaknesses, and I would hope that the council, through its appointments committee particularly, might spend some more time reviewing each of the individual recommendations, as well as reaching out to some of the members of the affected boards and discussing with him what the views are. But I've tried to do the best job that I could in suggesting changes that I thought would strengthen the citizen participation process through boards and committees.
I just want to say to the town manager, before we get into what we're going to do with this, that this is quite a job in the time that you had, and I really appreciate it. The manager's recommendation is that we refer this to the appointments committee for their review. May I have a motion?
I would move that this gets referred to the appointments committee for its review, and I would also concur with your observation on how fine a report this was.
I'll second.
Moved and seconded that we refer this to the appointments committee for their review. Any discussion? Councilor Creelman?
Yes, I would also concur with all of the words that have been uttered already about this particular tome that has come out. But I would also like to give a public thanks to our former chairperson, Councilor McLaughlin, for really spending a majority of her chairperson's year structuring a tremendous review of the many boards and commissions in the town, so that the town manager had the information to really put together for this report this evening. It's an extraordinary job. Well done.
Councilor Jordan?
Yeah, I think it's a tremendous document, and I think it's great. It's something that probably should have been around years ago. But there's just a couple of comments, and maybe I don't quite understand the way it reads. In section 4-1-4, conflict of interest.
And one of the attachments.
One of the attachments. Don't have a page number, but that's okay. We'll excuse page number. Find it?
Yeah, that's...
It says no member of any board, commission, or committee shall introduce, speak, or vote on any motion or issue in which he has a conflict of interest, direct or indirect. My only point there is that, and I think it's good, all this and that, but sometimes somebody that might have an interest there would throw in some light as a comment of what you're trying to do. And in my opinion, the way this reads, that he wouldn't be allowed to do that. Sometime that somebody's in that field, and maybe he could clear up a point, but as I understand this reading, he wouldn't be allowed to do it. My other comment is responsibility for funds. The treasurer of the town of Kidlesworth shall receive an account for all funds collected by the trustees and shall make payment for these funds on orders signed by the town council. That's something new. They used to do it years ago when they were selectmen, but when they got to be council, they bypassed that. But it's something that should be done. Is that correct?
Yeah.
I'll give you the authority to do it.
That maybe that's something the appointments committee ought to look at. That's been language that's been carried forward since 1945. Technically, under Maine statute, the council is supposed to sign a warrant
that's
for
correct.
Every dollar that goes out of this building prior to it going out. The council amended the ordinance at one point so that the chairman of the council and chairman of the finance committee would sign the warrants. In practice, that has not occurred for about 10 years. The council instead receives monthly reports based that shows, you know, what spending has occurred. The council does not, as most councils today, does not review individual warrants for every expense.
But I believe the school department, they still do it.
School board still reviews school warrants after the checks have gone out.
I'm not looking at that.
Councilor Feller?
I want to, I think the idea of having the boards set goals and set a budget is an excellent idea. It's following through with our wanting the town to be run in a more business-like manner. It's a good recommendation, Michael. So therefore, I move that we forward this to the Appropriations Committee. Appointments Committee. See, we're talking about money here. The Appointments Committee, and have them make a recommendation back to the council. I realize we also have an opening for the chairman of that committee as well.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Further discussion? All those in favor, if they refer to the appointments, 7-0. Thank you. Item number 43. To consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding the road classification standard chart that has been proposed for the subdivision ordinance and take any necessary action. Councilor Conneshaw.
Yes, in our July meeting, the Ordinance Committee decided to eliminate the road classification standard table in that we felt that each individual project should be considered for its own individual merit, and the town council, with advice from the manager and chief of police, would be the ones who would determine whether or not parking would be allowed. That was the way our discussion went, Michael. What was the frown?
No, just that specific parking prohibitions need to be added to the traffic schedule after the public hearing within the traffic regulation board.
So we go through the usual process that we go through. And you make recommendations.
Yeah, or the public comes forward.
Yeah, okay.
Usually, most of those have been enacted as a result of citizens saying they want parking, don't want parking.
That was a 3-0 vote.
You're going to move that, are you?
I did.
You did. Are you going to have it seconded?
I would second that.
We got it moved and seconded. Any discussion? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I apologize for being late this evening and missing the conversation about the town center plan, but I don't know if you discussed then about reclassifying part of Route 77 from an arterial to something of a lesser degree, but I hope that is something that our planning board will consider in due course. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other discussion? Ready for the question? All those in favor, signify. 7-0. Thank you. Item number 44. To consider a recommendation from the Appointments Committee regarding a vacancy on the Arts Commission and take any necessary action. Councilor Creel.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. This recommended appointment is somewhat akin to doing something like appointing former President Bush to the Board of Historic Preservation. I had a delightful experience in finding out through Councilor Marvin that Maestro Shimada, who lives in Cape Elizabeth, very much desired to volunteer his talent and skills to the town of Cape Elizabeth. And at the time this information became known to me, we just happened to have one opening in our board and commission system, and that was a position on the Arts Commission. And when I spoke with him and he asked me what the criteria was for joining the Arts Commission, I said that one had to have an appreciation for the arts. And it's obvious that Maestro Shimada more than has an appreciation for the arts, and we are delighted on behalf of the Appointments Committee to be appointing him to the Arts Commission this evening, and I would move the appointment.
I'd like to second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 45. To consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding proposed amendments to the subdivision regulations regarding engineering reviews and take any necessary action. Councilor Conneshaw?
Yes. Perhaps this could be better explained by our town manager. But it has come as a recommendation from the manager, I believe, also the planner, that in order to expedite some of the approvals for subdivisions, some of the delays are caused by having our own town engineer have to review every step of the way. If the applicant hasn't submitted all the information that has been requested, then the town engineer needs to review things again. They believe that having a special escrow account that is paid for by the developer, that is used to also pay for our town engineer to do these reviews, might make the developer a little more willing to meet the deadlines that are necessary and not duplicating information. Michael, what would you like to add?
Just that there's a sheet before the council this evening that makes technical amendments to the zoning ordinance. Mm-hmm. And when you make technical amendments to the zoning ordinance, it does need to be reviewed by the planning board so that they can hold a public hearing as well. And make any amendments to the zoning ordinance, not just technical. So if the council wants to move this forward, you would need to refer to the planning board.
Councilor Congressman.
I move that we refer this to the planning board for review and public hearing, and that their recommendations be forwarded to the town manager in time for the November town council agenda.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. There is one part of the revisions that is not especially pertinent necessarily to the review escrow fees, but the fact that there is a recommendation to decrease the number of required drawings to be submitted. I did discuss that with the planner today, expressed my pleasure that we were able to see a decrease that also would represent a decrease in cost to the developers, and I was very pleased to see that we could move in that direction.
Thank you. Further discussion? Councilor Jordan.
I have trouble with part of this, and the part that I have a problem with is that the developer is going to pay the whole bill for his representation and also for the town representation. And I feel if the town wants somebody to represent him, that they should pay for that. And I don't believe in asking somebody else to pay the bill for me if I'm having someone represent me as far as putting a plan together. And I know it's a good way of doing it if you can do it. And as I read the memos, other communities have done it. I just get a little wary of what might happen down the road, and if one guy is going to do all the work and represent the town and represent the developer, I get a little nervous about it and being paid by the developer. Whoever pays a bill, they're usually pretty clear on their decisions as far as what might be done and might have to be done. And I just can't buy it.
Councilor Congressman?
As part of our discussion this that evening, we had with us a landscape architect who has worked in this similar kind of arrangement in other towns and has found it to be very efficient, very effective. If we have a town engineer, he would only be the most professional person, and he wouldn't be bowing to pressure from a developer to do something other than what the town or the planning board would want him to do. So I don't think we have to worry about who's paying the piper in that particular instance. Towns of Wyndham, Freeport, and Cumberland do this and find it to be a much more expeditious way. We've had long-standing complaints about how long it takes for sites to developments to be approved by the planning board. Part of the problem is that they don't meet all the basic engineering requirements at the beginning. We know we need to look at giving our planner a little more authority as far as determining whether or not something is complete. But if you submit something once or twice to the town engineer instead of three and four times, you're saving money in the long run, not only for the town, but also for the developer.
Thank you. Councilman Bowman.
As I understand this, the town would be paying the bills. Money would be received from the developer and put in escrow for the town to make the payments. So while the developer is footing the cost, it is the town that is contracting with an engineer and paying them.
Thank you. Further discussion? We have a motion on the floor that this be...
Forwarded to the planning board.
And second. All those in favor of the motion? Six, favor, against, one. Six, one. Thank you. Item number 46. To consider authorizing a grant application to PAC for a transportation enhancement project and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Under the new Federal Intermodal Surface Transportation Efficiency Act, known as ICT, that we can apply for a lot of different areas rather than traditional highway projects. We looked at this and looked at the criteria and determined that there was a possibility that we might be able to receive some funds to extend the boardwalk surrounding Great Pond to the other side of Idlewild Brook beyond what's already been done. The grant application is for $46,200. The local share, should this be approved, would be $9,240. This would be done sometime during the next 2 to 3 years. It would not be done this year because the funds take a while to go. PAC will be reviewing the applications at their policy committee meeting on Thursday afternoon. If you don't approve this, we simply won't have it reviewed by them.